Hey guys, welcome back. In today's video, we're going to look at Laravel Pennant, which is a new feature that was released with Laravel 10. Now, Laravel Pennant is a feature flag plugin for Laravel, which has been developed by the Laravel team themselves. I have a fresh installation of Laravel 10, and to get started, we need to install the plugin Laravel Pennant. And in order to do that, we do it with this command, composer require Laravel Pennant. Okay, now that the plugin has been installed, we need to publish the configuration, and we can do it by using the following command. PHP artisan vendor publish dash dash provider and the Laravel pennant string. Now, as you can see, we published the configuration in order to get access to the config file and the database migration. Now, by default, pennant uses the database in order to store its feature flags, but that can be changed to use an in-memory array by accessing it through the config file, which is under app config pennant.php. And this is where you can change the default. In our case, we're going to keep the default and use the database as our feature flag driver. So we just need to run the migration in order for our table to be created. Now, there are two ways for defining a feature in Laravel Pennant. Now, the first way we're going to do it is in the app service provider. And we're going to use the example within the Laravel documentation on their website by defining a new API feature. Now, in order for us to utilize the feature flags, we are only going to check it against the isInternal team member attribute that we've added to the user model. So as you can see on the user model, we've added it as an attribute and we've cast it to be a Boolean. Okay, so the next thing we're going to do is to implement the actual check. And we're going to do that in the user controller under the show method, because we defined our API route to use the show method in order to differentiate between the two different API responses we're going to use within this feature flag. So back in our user controller, we define or we check the feature if it's active using the new API key, and this key needs to be the same as the one we defined in our app service provider. Now, if this feature flag is active for the user, then it's going to resolve or return the new API response. Otherwise, it'll return the legacy response. And if we look at the API resources themselves, on the legacy resource, we've currently specified that we've got a first name, a last name, an email, and a full name. Now, full name is just an attribute that takes the first name and last name, concatenates it, and then returns it. Now, with regards to the new API, this is where we're going to implement the feature flag. We're just going to say that we don't want the full name to be returned anymore, but we want to add a field to the database and give the users an option to make their display name customizable. So we removed the full name and added the display name as the extra field. Now, in order for us to test this, I've set up a PHP unit test, and we will be running tests in order to see what our different API responses or resources will look like. So just to explain what this test is doing, it should return the legacy API response. So we're creating a user with the internal team member set as false. Then we take that response and we create a snapshot of it. Then our next test is just the opposite. It should return the new API response. So we set the flag on that user that we create where it says the internal team member is true, and then we expect the new API resource or response to be returned. Okay, now we can run our tests and see what our responses look like in our snapshots. All right, so if we go to our snapshots, our first snapshot is the legacy response, where we can see it returns the first name, last name, email, and full name, which is correct, which we expected. And the next response is the new response, the new API response, which is gives you the first name, the last name, email, and the display name, which is also correct as we expected. Now, the second way that we can implement feature flags is by using class-based feature flags. And we can create one by running the following command, php artisan pennant colon feature, and then the name of your class. In this case, we're going to use new API. Now, in order to implement the class-based feature flag, there's only a couple of things that we need to do. The first thing is in our app service provider, we're going to disable the previous one we've defined. In our case, we're just going to comment it out. And the second thing that we need to do is in the user controller where we check the flag, instead of a string, we now implement the class name itself. Okay, and the last thing that we need to do is to define the feature flag. And you can find the flags under app, features, and then the class that we've just created. In our case, we can just take the return false out based in the code snippet from the website itself. We can then clean up this code a little. And by default, or not by default, usually you would use the user model or the authenticated user in order to check your feature flags. So in our case, we're going to change this to be a user, and we'll change that to be user as well. And then that should be it. Now we can run our test again, and our test should automatically pass because we've just implemented, or we just changed the way we do our feature flag. So let's run PHP unit and see what happens. And there we go. Our test still passed, meaning that our feature flag is still set correctly, even though we changed it to from defining it in the app service provider to a class-based feature flag. And that's it for this video, guys. Thank you so much for watching, and see you in the next one.